Good day, everyone. Welcome to Prayer Watch. We shall now begin with a word of prayer. We praise you and we thank you, loving God and Father in heaven, for one more day, one more opportunity to gather around your throne of grace and mercy and wisdom, to look into your word and to hear your voice and to prepare our hearts to receive your revelation, your message for each one of us. We ask for your leading, O God, your Holy Spirit, anointing to be upon each and every one of us. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord, for every sin that we have committed against you, against our neighbor, that may stand in the way of our hearing, our understanding, and even of our prayers. We trust you, O God, to be faithful, and we trust, Lord, your mercy to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We praise you, Lord, and we glorify your name, now and always, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hebrews 3. But Christ is faithful as the Son over God's house, and we are his house, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. So as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested and tried me, though for 40 years they saw what I did. That is why I was angry with that generation. I said, their hearts are always going astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end.
We praise God for his wonderful words of life. How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. So goes the first line of a popular sonnet by a celebrated English poet, Elizabeth Barrett Browning. It is said that she composed that poem for her husband to express her love and devotion to him, masterfully through the use of the English language. However, to express our love for God, what does the Bible say? Once, Jesus rebuked a group of Pharisees and teachers of the law in the practice of their religion. He said, "You hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. You break the command of God for the sake of your tradition. The things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart, and these defile them. Evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what defile a person. And these, according to Jesus, are the things that keep us from truly loving and worshiping God." Our scripture text today likewise examines our hearts as Jesus examined the hearts of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Jesus used the image of hearts that are far from God, while Hebrews 3 adopts the expression such as hardened hearts and hearts that are going astray, taken from Psalm 95. All of these have the same idea about the opposite of loving God. Ang paggalang o pagsamba sa Diyos na pakunwari lamang dahil sa bibig at hindi sa puso ito bumubukal. Ito yung tulad ng mga pusong naging parang bato na, mga pusong napariwara at nawala na, napalayo sa Panginoon. How then are we supposed to love God genuinely, that is, from the heart? When Jesus spoke about a heart that is, or a love that is from the heart, he was not referring to the feeling or the emotions, the emotional aspect of love, but nothing less than God's kind of love. And what is God's kind of love? In the Bible, it is termed as agape. Agape is a Greek word that means God's immeasurable, incomparable, unconditional love for humankind, which is so very well expressed in the verse John 3:16 that says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." Agape love goes well beyond emotions, sentiments, or feelings. It is demonstrated by action. A leading theologian said, agape is unmotivated in the sense that it is not contingent on any value or worth in the object of love. Ang ibig sabihin nito ay ang agape na isang uri ng pag-ibig na pag-ibig ng Diyos para sa sangkatauhan ay isang pagmamahal na hindi nababatay kung karapat-dapat ba o hindi ang minamahal, kundi nanggagaling lamang sa bukal na pag-ibig ng nagmamahal. Kaya ganoon ang pag-ibig ng Diyos. God's agape love was a love in action. He gave his Son, Jesus Christ, and a self-sacrificing love. Jesus gave his life to pay for the sins of every person who would believe in him. Now, because of this divine love that a believer has received, the Bible teaches that the believer should also learn to love as God loves. First of all, to love God above all and to love neighbor as oneself. Now, for this message from our scripture text today, let us focus on teaching how to love God above all, because he first loved us with an agape kind of love. And so the Bible says, we love God because he first loved us. Hindi ba't napakadakila at napakalawak ng pag-ibig ng Diyos para sa atin, kaya dapat lang na matuto din tayo na mahalin siya, suklian ang ganitong uri ng pag-ibig. Dahil iyan ang nais niyang mangyari sa ating buhay, ang matutunan din siyang ibigin dahil iniibig niya tayo. Ipinakita niya ito sa atin at inaasahan niya na tayo naman ay matuto rin na magmahal sa kanya. Hebrews 3 teaches us how to love God by showing us first the negative example of Israel's experience so that we may be warned against falling into the same mistake as they committed in the past. Now, let us see the lessons that we can learn. First, hardened hearts forget or undervalue even God's miraculous acts. Ang matitigas na puso ay nakakalimot o hindi pinapahalagahan kahit ang mga himala na ginawa ng Diyos. The book of Hebrews was first addressed to the Jews who had received the gospel of Jesus Christ and believed in Him, and to encourage them to persevere in their faith and not to give up in the midst of the hardships and the persecutions that they were experiencing at that time because of their faith. Now, quoting from Psalm 95, the writer of Hebrews says in verses 7 to 10, "So, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested and tried me. Though for 40 years they saw what I did, that is why I was angry with that generation." Now, what miracles, what things did God refer to that the ancestors saw within the 40 years that God has led them in the wilderness? Well, we can name a few of them. First, we know about the parting of the Red Sea. The Red Sea turned into dry land so that about 1.5 million Israelites were able to cross the sea and escape the army of Pharaoh in Egypt and move on into the across the desert. Secondly, they were fed with manna from heaven and quails daily for the next 40 years so that they did not hunger nor did they thirst. They were guided by a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night so that they would know when to stay in a place and camp and when to leave and move on. Also, we remember that the miracle that God did when they were bitten by the poisonous snakes, but as long as they obeyed Him, His instruction to look up to the bronze snake on the pole that He commanded Moses to lift up, they would be spared and they would live despite having been attacked or bitten by the snake. And in spite of this things and many more, yet time and again throughout their desert wanderings, the Israelites fell into bouts of disobedience and grumbling. How about in our situation these days? How many miracles do we need to see or experience in our lives to be convinced that God is true and that He loves us? Imagine the miracle of salvation, that God should love us enough to forgive us our sins and satisfy the justice of His holiness, where we sinful people, sinful as we are, should have been given the sentence of death, should suffer the wrath of God. And yet, because of the miracle of His love and salvation, Jesus sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on our behalf. So, how can we show our love to God? Let us never forget that miracle of salvation, and let us also be acutely alert and aware of every situation, big or small, where we see the hand of God's miracle in our lives. Naniniwala ako na ang bawat Kristiyano, bawat isa sa atin, ay nakaranas ng higit sa isa pang milagro na nangyari sa ating buhay dahil sa pag-ibig ng Diyos sa atin. Kayo ba ay napagaling sa isang sakit? Kayo ba ay nakaiwas sa isang sakuna o isang peligro na alam ninyo ay talaga namang kung wala ang kamay ng Panginoon ay napahamak na kayo? Ang inyo bang
mga kamag-anak o isang kaibigan ay tumanggap sa Panginoong Jesus sa kabila ng kanyang halos parang wala ng pag-asa, ngunit sa milagro ng Panginoon ay tumanggap sa Panginoong Jesus. Marami pa pong mga iba't ibang mga milagro. May mga maliliit na milagro. Kayo ba minsan ay parang nawala na sa daan at hindi na ninyo alam kung saan kayo pupunta? Subalit kayo ay nakarating pa dahil may isang anghel na pinadala ang Panginoon. Biglang may taong dumaan doon sa kaling yun na wala namang dumadaan na dahil madilim na, gabi na, pero merong nagturo sa inyo ng daan at kayo ay nakaiwas sa iba pang mga kapahamakan. Marami ang masasabi natin mga milagro ng Panginoon. Milagro ng pagtanggap ng biyaya, no? Kung sa panahon na talagang walang-wala na tayo, tayo ay nakatanggap ng mga pinansyal na tulong sa paraan na hindi man lamang natin naisip kung paano nangyari yun. Second lesson that we can learn is that hard times make it so tempting for us to doubt God, to give up godliness, and to give in to backsliding. Kapag naghihirap, madaling matukso na mawala ng tiwala sa Diyos, sumuko sa pagsisikap na mamuhay ayon sa kabanalan ng Diyos, at bumalik sa dating gawing makasalanan. At one point, when they were terrified that Pharaoh's soldiers might catch up with them, the Israelites cried out to Moses, complained to him and said, "What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Imagine, they would have preferred being slaves, to continue to be slaves, and to continue to be tempted to worship the idols of Egypt, than to suffer in the desert temporarily, because they thought that they would not be able to escape those temporary or momentary times of hardships. At another time, they grumbled about the scarcity of food. During the first 2 months after they came out of Egypt, and they said they would have been better off in Egypt where there was a lot of food. They thought they were better off as slaves as long as they had food on the table. Hindi ba't minsan kapag hirap sa buhay, natutukso ang Kristiyano, naisuko ang kanilang mga prinsipyong pinanghahawakan sa Biblia, isuko ang mga katuruan ng Panginoon. Hindi na baling tumanggap ng suhol, basta maingat, basta't maiangat lang ang buhay. O kaya sumama o sumang-ayon na lang sa kaibigan, sa kapamilya, o sa mas nakararami, kahit baluktot ang desisyon para wala ng away dahil mahirap ang ipaglaban kung ano ang tama. There are some people who have become so glued to the old ways of doing things, including in the tradition of worship, that because there is no face-to-face worship available at the moment in their Christian church, they have turned to other ways of worshiping, going back to the idolatrous practices which they have renounced, simply because they are longing to be in a church. In a church building, no matter what. Dahil sa kagustuhan na maibalik yung dating gawi, na nakasanayan na, na pagsamba doon sa isang lugar kung saan makikita mo na ikaw ay nasa ilalim ng isang gusali o sa isang lugar na kayo ay magsama-sama upang magsamba, ay kahit saan na lang, no? Para masabi lang na kayo ay nakapagsimba, kahit na ang pinasukan ninyo ay iba na ang tinuturo o bumabalik na sa dating mga baluktot na paniniwala sa relihiyon. Now, this reminds us of how the Israelites at one point in time couldn't wait for Moses to get back to the ground from the mountain where he was in an audience with God. And since it was taking so long for Moses to come back, the people were so fed up with waiting, that they wanted to worship no matter what. So they made for themselves golden calves and started worshiping the idols that they have made. They were used to those idolatrous practices in the past that they have seen, where they were where they had been foreigners or slaves, like in Egypt. And so, because of, you know, the tradition of men, because of what you have been used to doing, okay, in the external, then they have given up the true essence of worship. And God was so angry at them. Jesus said that there are people who receive the word of God with so much joy at first. They believe for a while, but when the time of testing comes, they fall away, or they are choked by the worries of life so that they do not mature. We know of some Christians who have backslidden, who have gone astray, and are no longer persevering in the faith because of hard times, because of pressure from friends, pressure from work, pressure from circumstances in life that they cannot deal with. How do you love God? The world over today, and for many months already, majority of people, including Christians, are hard up materially, financially, physically, perhaps spiritually, because they could not adjust to the new mode of worship. These are times of great testing, indeed. Mahirap talaga ang panahon ngayon, mga kapatid. At yan ay tinatanggap nating lahat. But these are times when we are tested to give up, to give in. So let us be warned and be alert to these temptations. The third and last lesson for us today is on how we may then truly love God and not be hardened in our hearts. It is amazingly simple. And Hebrews 3 tells us, to keep your love for God strong, encourage each other, and do everything to learn from God's word daily. Magtulungan ang bawat Kristiyano at sikaping matuto mula sa salita ng Diyos araw-araw upang mapalalim ang pag-ibig sa Diyos. Verse 12 says, see to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. Our Christian faith is a faith shared in community with fellow believers. Let us not give up the meeting together, even if it is online. But let us spur one another on towards love and good deeds, all the more as we see the day approaching. When we meet with well-meaning and with mature Christians leading us in the study of the Bible, we will avoid the temptation to give up, to give in, and to grumble. And these things, giving up, giving in, and grumbling, hardens the heart towards God. Instead, these meetings that we should continue to practice and make every effort to do, make us see the goodness of God, His miraculous ways. This will deepen our understanding of Him, His will through His word, and encourage us to do what is right, what is good, and glorifying. Kapag nagsasama-sama kasi tayo at napag-aaralan natin ang salita ng Diyos, doon natin nakikita kung saan tayo nagkukulang, kung saan tayo umuunlad, at nagtutulungan ang bawat isa. Kung mayroong naghihina, napapalakas, kung mayroong namang nalilihis o naniligaw ng landas, ay maingat din nating nasasaway. At dapat ay tinatanggap niya ito dahil ito ay para sa kanyang kabutihan upang hindi tumigas ang kanyang puso at mawala ang tunay na pag-ibig sa Diyos. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, how do you love God? How do we love God? How do we as a church love God? True love for God is much more than feelings, emotions, confessions of words, or even just intentions. Intentions of doing something, but it only stays, they only stay in the mind. Agape is love in action. Love for God in action. And that action includes being responsible for making sure we do not come to the point of hard-heartedness. Let us not be deceived by merely thinking, feeling, and confessing with gentle words or even with sweet songs a love for God, but positively and even sacrificially do what He commands us to do. If you love me, obey my commands. Then we can truly say, I love you, Lord, and God knows that it is true. Thank you.
Let us pray. Our loving God and Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for your agape love, that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You loved us incomparably, unconditionally, just as we were, and even just as we are today. Lord, thank you that your words truly are powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. They penetrate, even dividing soul and spirit. Thank you, Father, that whenever we take responsibility for learning from you, there is no way we can escape, O Lord, the hammering and the purifying power of your word. Salamat, Panginoon, na ang salita niyo ay tunay na makapangyarihan, nakapaglalambot, nakapagdudurog ng matigas naming puso, at nakapagpapalinis kung anuman ang aming mga maduming pag-iisip, ang aming mga mali at baluktot na paniniwala. Thank you, Lord, that you have made it clear how it is that we should love you. We cannot depend on our own reasoning or understanding. Thank you for your word, Lord. And thank you, Holy Spirit, that you will testify, you will convict our hearts truly whether we are loving God with all our hearts or if we are just going through the motions of an empty worship. Lord, we present ourselves to you because we know you know everything, you know our hearts. And we ask, Lord, for your mercy, we ask for your help, we ask for your power to change us, to soften our hearts, so that we may truly love you the way you want us to. Father, we pray for ourselves, we pray for our church. We also pray, Lord, for our family and friends. And we pray for those people whom we are trying to reach, even through our evangelism and church planting efforts. We pray, O God, that despite the distance, despite the difficulties of the times, your word will reach them as we continue to come together, study your word, to pray and encourage one another. Lord, I pray that each one of us will embrace your message for us tonight and act on them. Because indeed, Lord, our love for you is a love that truly acts in obedience. Thank you, Lord. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with us today once again, and we hope that your prayers tonight will indeed be filled with so much love for the Lord. Goodbye, everyone. God bless us.